listen to us.
Oh,
apostles we praise this morning. Telling you praise you. It is our bounty, Jehovah God. We are here because of your grace, O Lord. It is not by might, it is not by power. We are here today, Jehovah God. We enter your courts with praise, O God. We enter your courts with praise this morning. We enter your gates with thanksgiving. Just open up your mouth this morning and thank him for what he has done in your life today. This is the first week of February. He has been holding our hands throughout 2018 and even throughout the month of January. And even today we can stand here and declare that it is not by might, it is not by power. It is not because you have been so good. It is not because of our good deeds, but it is by his grace. Just thank him this morning. Just lift up your mouth and worship and tell him thank you. Thank you to Jesus for protecting my family. Thank you, Jesus, for protecting my children. Thank you, Jesus, for protecting me. We have been treading out to snow, but you have protected us, oh God. You have preserved our lives, oh Jehovah. And therefore this morning, we lift up our hands and we thank you for what you have done for us. We don't ask for the people in hospital this morning. My Father, but you have spared us this morning, oh God. We worship you this morning. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you.
Yeah.
sins of your people this day. In the mighty name of Jesus, let the church say, let the church say,
I'm Kayla from St. Louis.
Okay.
I'm glad that you jumped into the network.
in Hinga, not to be a new cover in this church, but welcome in us are.
Pastor Texas.
Jesus, you are stronger for than any other. Hallelujah.
the choir come, the children can go to the Sunday school classes, please, as the choir comes in. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And we want to Illinois, Shackelford. She said, that is what. Italian, and she came from, I think she's like almost fourth generation from Sweden, and she said all this long story. And then all of a sudden, everything changed, and she said, can you come and I introduce you to my pastor? And I said, yes, I did not know where to start, but here comes, just because of the book. And he said, okay, let's go to the office, and I found this pastor called Ron Brock. And he said, okay, I met her, and I thought, okay, I said, oh, no, the lady said, no, he was in this book, and I'm very curious, because this is where my sister is buried. Can I take this book to read, and I'll bring it back to you? I said, yes. And she was very powerful in the church committee for the sale of the building. And then when they had a meeting for the, whatever, they had the board for the sale for the building, and she knew I had said they're looking for a building, she said that this, a group of Kenyans, they are on that 625 Shackelford Road, they are looking for a church to buy. But we were already like $2,000 in debt. We didn't have money because we had bought a swing set for the kids, which was $3,100, and we paid $1,100. And so we had $2,000 to pay. So I'm looking for a building for $860,000 with a $2,000 debt. Doesn't work like that in America. But anyway, and I explained that to her. She said, don't worry, we have paid off this church, and we are dying off. The youngest pastor in this church is 57 years old. And she quit coming because every time at the end of the service, everybody wanted her to build the chair and hey, honey, help me here, honey, help me there. She quit the church. And so she said, how many kids do you have? I said, we have 98 kids. We don't know what to put them during winter. She said, okay, I'll talk to the board. I'll talk to the board. You know what happened? The board met. They said, as you look for money, here's the key. Get your people here in this building. And don't worry about any utility here. We'll pay for the next 3 months. That's how we ended up buying that building, because we are had enough time to raise the money. And guess what cost of that? Reading the book in one spirit. It is very important for us to have the Bible. And I don't believe in the phones. A phone is not a Bible. Because inside the phone there are so many other bad things inside there. And I don't think there's anything bad in this Bible, but in the phone, somebody is going to text you stuff that you don't want to hear. Somebody is mad at you, sending some images you don't like. That cannot happen in the Bible. So it's very important for us to find the Bible. For me, it doesn't matter King James Version or New King James Version or Young King James Version. It doesn't matter. All this, the Bible is about when it's a good. So we are going to be looking at the Second Corinthians. First Corinthians. Can we explain the scriptures, please? And the reason we have been, for the last few months, or maybe weeks, we have been talking about how to overcome, trials and temptations, how to overcome predicaments. There we go. Corinthians. And the reason why, you know, we are hard pressed. That's what, and to start by saying, we are hard pressed. And this church has been very, very hard pressed for the last, since January of 2018. And all to realize, for the fire upon through this, and I can be real with you. I have been looking for people who have gone through things. And this church is standing because God has been involved in the movement of this church for the last many years, almost 19 years, 20 years. That's why we waste time. That's why we are here. That's why we are here. And the Bible says we are hard pressed. And not on one side, but it says every side. When the Bible says every side, it means you have no room to move. It is every side. Whether it's financial, people are hard pressed. Relationships, people are hard pressed. The health, sickness, people are hard pressed. I don't know anybody here who is not hard pressed. And when the Bible says hard, it is hard. It's not a soft press. It is hard press. I go to Israel every year. I was there last year. And I went to this place where they press the olives. And the oil that we buy, baking oil, which is from the olives, we just buy it, we see it's clean and pure. But I'm telling you, for them to extract that oil from the seed, from the olives, it is a process. It is a process. And of course, 2 years ago, we went with some ladies to this place in Israel called the Gethsemane. Gethsemane means a place of rest. Right there outside, they used to press the olive and they'll get oil, anointing oil, they get the cooking oil, they get the lamp oil which they burn. They get all this oil from that one seed, the olives. So when the Bible says hard pressed, it is real being hard pressed. To a point where you feel it inside yourself. And you're not even able to share with anyone. Or in the middle of the night, you can just wake up and cry over yourself, hard pressed. And the Bible says, even when you go through all this, you are not crushed. And I was trying to find out, how can anybody go through this kind of hard and difficult situations and circumstances like yet, you're able to stand. I know how many people call us and say, I don't know how I am able to stand. And unless you find that something that is not outside you, something must be inside you for you to be able to stand, you cannot stand. And so I've been looking for people who can again relate to it. In the Bible and in the world, and I was reading a little bit about Rick Warren, who is a famous preacher in California and with 50,000 church members. And he went through some stuff, if you want to go and find out. He went through some stuff, very, very difficult stuff. And how many times he wrote to the board and said, I want to quit preaching. I don't want to preach anymore. I feel I can't. And God continued to speak to him. And he said, you have to soldier on. And I was reading the Bible, the man got Job, and you have heard about Job. And I was telling people last Sunday that sometimes you just read the Bible and like a literature. So you read the Bible just because there's a book called Job, you're going to read, and you just read and laugh and think that there's a man who did not leave. God, he did live, and he walked in this world. He did. Everything that the Bible says that when he went through, he did go through. Everything that the Bible says his father went through, he did go through. It is not just something that was put there for us to read, and he just say, oh, it's another book written for us. But it did happen. And another name, a woman called Naomi. Now we went through the same thing, and she went to Moab with her family. And she's married by this man called Abimelech. And they have two boys, Kilion and Aaron and Maru, and they go to the land. They think they are going to the land and everything will be good, just like when we came here to America. And when they get there, they did not turn out to be the way they thought. The husband, Abimelech, died. We don't know how he died. The Bible does not say what kind of disease he got. But he died. That was a real man who lived, and he died. In a foreign land, you know how hard it is. For us Kenyans here, we have experienced, I don't know how many times we have sent bodies back to Kenya. I don't know. just very hard. And so now he is there and she has lost her husband. And I don't know what happened to the boys. Marlon also died. And he just got married. He died also. And then after dying, his brother, Kirion, also dies after getting married. And this woman is left by herself in a foreign land with two daughters who have no cultural connection. Because they were Moabites, they were not Jews. It was very hard for this woman. I can tell you, this is a woman who lived. This is a woman who we can identify with. And she told everybody, don't call me my name anymore. Don't call me my name. Don't call me now. Call me Mara, which means I have suffered bitterness. I have suffered like nobody else. And I've lost my husband. I have lost my only two boys. I am left with the two fallen ladies. And I don't know what to do. And she said, I have to go back to Bethlehem. And she wants to go back to Bethlehem. And these two women says, we'll go with you. And one along the way says, no, I'll go back. And she went back. But Ruth said, I am going to go with you. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. And everything that Naomi persuaded her to do, she refused and followed her all the way to Bethlehem. What I'm saying is, she was hard-pressed. And when we say even hard-pressed, we are really underestimating the strength of that word, the power of that word. Hard-pressed. And this church has been going through this. There is a man in the Bible who wants to read, because we wanted to be out of here by 1 o'clock. We have good food that is waiting for us. So this man is called Paul. And this man has traveled quite a bit. And he has gone through things. And I want us to read the 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and see what has happened to this man. I can identify some kind of this man. I was in Greece 2 years ago. And when I was in Athens, and we are taking a ship and I went to the island of Patmos, I could see the open sea that goes all the way to Tel Aviv. Open sea. And I can imagine, this is the same sea that Paul used to sail through. This is the same sea that Paul is describing in the scripture. And sometimes it can be very stormy. And if you read that book, we're going to read that because yeah, this is what it says. Second Corinthians chapter. Listen to what happened to Paul. He says he was suffering not for anybody else but for Christ. And the Bible says that these Jews who actually belong to his own culture and his own people, he said, okay, are you Hebrews? They said, so I am. Are they Israelites? So I am. Are they the seed of Abraham? So I am, the Bible says. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more in labor, more abundant. And he says, in stripes above measure, in prison, the Bible says, Paul was in prison. And he says, more frequently, in death. He says, from the Jews, 5 times I received 40 stripes minus one. That is real beating. And then he says, I received 3 times I was beaten with rods. We are not talking of just what we call in our Kenyan famous term, moiko. Because if you tell our kids, oh, I'm going to take the moiko, they run away. But this was not a moiko, this was not a stick. He talks about rods. And 3 times I was beaten with rods. This is a man who was in trouble. And he says, once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. And that's when I remember, oh, when I saw when he was in the sea, and the boat or whatever ship they were from, he's wrecked in the middle of the night. And the Bible says, at night and day, I have been in the deep in the deep sea, in journeys often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and toil, in sleeplessness, often in cold and nakedness. Can you imagine? Beside the other things that comes upon me daily, my deep concern was for all the churches. Even going through all this, he still inside was just thinking about the churches. And when we talk about the church, we're not talking about the building. He was thinking about the people who had accepted Jesus Christ. How many people are here who can be in prison? In prison, naked, beaten many times, hungry, no food, no water to drink. And yet inside yourself, you're just thinking about the saints outside there. I have never been to jail. But we have worked there as chaplains back in Kenya. And we always go there during the day, but we go back home around 4 o'clock. But I don't know what was happening in Kabiti prison. That is one of the places nobody wanted to go in Kenya. But we went there, and there were so many people there. But at night, I don't know what they went through. But I can imagine they were always thinking back their homes, about maybe their father, their wives, their children. But Paul did not mention about his mother, did not mention about his brothers and sisters. He said every moment in prison, in these struggles, he only remembered about the church. And he says in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, verse 7, he says, and this is something that he was passionately speaking about when he was in trouble. And he said, at least I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations. And he said, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, was given to him. A thorn in the flesh was given to him. It was not a thorn that just came because he was walking without barefoot. It's not a thought that he acquired through the meetings, but the Bible says he was given a thorn in the flesh, was given to him. A messenger of Satan to perfect me, lest I will be exalted above measure. With all the credentials that Paul had, he was a accomplished lawyer, we know that. We know that he got his education through this very famous professor called Gamaliel. And anybody who went through that man came out a very articulate and very smart person, and Paul was one of them. And he says, because of all this, I had a thorn in my flesh so that I do not exalt myself. And the Bible says, concerning these things, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And the Lord said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. So I do not know why we suffer sometimes, and I do not know that God can make his grace perfect when we are all happy and everybody is happy and doing very well. But the Bible says, in that suffering, God's strength is made perfect in our weakness. I was asking myself, how can we stand? How can we be able to go through all these things? I was counting how many people are back in Kenya in the last year. bury their brother, their mother, their father. Every Sunday here we had to raise money. And you raised over $86,000 last year. Just to send back people back home to bury their loved ones. And I don't know how they stood. But I came to realize the only reason why and the reason we are able to stand is because the strength of God Himself is made perfect when we are there. And nobody else can come at this moment. Nobody. Nobody can come and occupy that place. Only God. I wonder people who do not know God, what they do. I know some of them, they just shoot themselves. They can't leave. And we know many cases of people who do that. They can leave. They just can't see tomorrow coming. Even for small things, in relationships, people love each other and the relationship goes bad and they just shoot themselves and they shoot the other one and they shoot children and nobody. And they can't survive. Because they have nowhere else to hang on. They have nowhere else they can hold on. And I realize now Paul was able to persevere all this because the strength of the Lord was made in his lowest moment in his life. Like the way God has done in our case. The Bible says in Acts 9, that in verse 16, this is what it says. Then Ananias, the man who God sent to Paul, Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard from many about this man who is called Paul, and how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. Ananias has heard Paul, and he has bad things about him. And if you have never been to Israel and you go to Golan Heights and you stand there in the mountain of Golan Heights and look far, that would be Damascus on the other side. And Paul will grab people from Jerusalem, from Damascus, and bring them to Jerusalem to be tried in the court by the high priest. That's what he used to do. And I wonder how he was able to travel all that just, and the Bible says, and he was breathing fire when he was going to Damascus. He was breathing fire to go and get all the people, all the Christians, and bring them to Jerusalem so that they can be persecuted. That was Paul. And so Ananias knew this man. That's why he says, yes, Lord, I hear you. But this man you are talking about is not a good man. And I know how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who call on your name. That was Paul. He had authority, he had the search warrant, he had everything given to him by the court of Jerusalem to go and arrest every Christian in Damascus and bring them to Jerusalem for trial. So Ananias hears this. But verse 15 says, of Acts 9, it says, but the Lord said to Ananias, go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. God has already conducted Saul. I will show you how many things he must suffer for my name's sake. I will show Paul, God is saying from heaven, I will show Paul how many things he will suffer, and we have already read all the things that he suffered. We have already read how he thought, oh, he was a thorn in the flesh, and he prayed three times, telling God, remove these thorns from my flesh. It was painful. And I know it's not just Paul, even Jesus himself. Son of God, right on the cross, he said, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. He was saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? Take away this thorn. But God said, this is for me to be glorified. Sometimes we go through things and we wonder, why? Why are we going through these things? Why not somebody else? And I have come to realize, when God wants to perfect somebody, when God wants to perfect his strength, there has to be some weakness. And verse 22 says, strengthening the soul of the disciples, exhorting them to continue in the faith and saying, we must through many tribulations enter into the kingdom. We must, through trials and temptations, enter into the kingdom. Because in the kingdom is not just sitting and drinking and eating and being happy. This kingdom, we must fight for it. We must fight for this kingdom. It is not easy. It is hard. Because the Bible requires us to behave like fools so that we can get into the kingdom. That's why I thank all the learned people we have in this church for their humility. Even though they have their PhDs, they have so many masters, and all the kind of education. But yet these people, they have humbled themselves, they have used their education, they have used their knowledge to advance God's kingdom. These are people who are wise, because they know, not even education, that can teach you. Yeah. It is good, it is good knowledge, but I wish that good knowledge can be used for the kingdom. I was a chaplain in Kenyatta National Hospital, and when I was there in Nairobi, and I will go to the ward, I will see a doctor that I know, and he knocked out because he's unconscious. And yet he's the doctor who was treating all these other people. But now he is at the last moment of his life. He can't help himself. And he's a doctor, a good doctor. And I wonder how can this be? This is a man with a lot of education. Got his master's in Cambridge in London. Went to the United States of America. Went to the best training center and back in Kenya and became ill, okay. Big doctor. Okay. And yet here he is, he can't help himself. And how shameful it is for me to ask him, do you know Jesus Christ? But he not answered because he cannot answer. We better believe in this God, because this world, we are just temporal here. We are not going to live here forever. We are not going to live here forever. There must be something. There must be something. I went to NASA in Orlando, Florida, and I see all these shadows that have gone and retired. I've seen all of them. And I guess what? I thought, oh, they just went to Mars. This went wherever they came back. But they have not discovered more. There is still more discovered, more and more. The Bible talks about the seventh heaven. I haven't heard NASA say we have discovered the seventh heaven in the Bible. They may never even discover it. Which means there is a place only those who fear God, only us guiding spirit will get it. I believe there is a place. My friend Mike, 1994, he astonished me. I asked him, Mike, you didn't invite me for your father's burial. And he said there was no. He said, what do you mean? Oh, no, he was not buried. Where is he? Oh, he's kept in a storage. And that's why I came together with him. Storage. And for what reason? Oh, he's going to be there frozen for so long, because we still believe sometime in America there will be some kind of scientific discovery whereby we'll be able to put souls or spirit back to this. And my father will come back. And this man is a fool, because one, how long is he going to live to see his father being resuscitated by the technology? They still believe that time will come. For us to believe in resurrection, we believe that the time will come and the trumpet will blow and we'll all be brought back. That's what we believe. This is the God that we serve. The Bible says in 1 Peter 4:12, verse 16, beloved, do not think it is strange concerning the fiery trials which is to try you, as though some strange things have happened. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's suffering, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceedingly joy. Verse 14 says, if you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of God and God of rest upon you. On their part he is a blaspheme, but on our part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer. Let none of you suffer as a murderer. Let none of you suffer as a thief. Let none of you suffer as evildoer. Let none of you suffer as a busybody in other people's matters. Yet, if anyone suffers as Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. We are suffering. But the Bible says we are not crushed. We can be knocked down, but we are not knocked out. We are still here. We are going to dust ourselves, we'll stand again, we still glorify God. We still glorify God. I was going to read this book whereby we can see what happened to Paul, but time did not allow us. I wanted to see whether we can get to the journey from Jerusalem all the way to Rome and going through all the sea for his trials and all the things that happened to him. And you see, as he was going and being taken there, the Bible says that it was not an easy journey. If you read from the book of Acts, 1 Corinthians, and go through, you are going to see Paul went through so many things. In fact, in some instance, they say that the whole 14 days, they did not see the sun, they did not see the stars, 14 days in the ocean. And he says, we were 276 prisoners in the boat, taken to Rome for trial. 276. And the boat experiences some storms, and they started throwing the cargo away so that the boat can be light on the ship. And now they say, now the next thing we are going to do is to throw the prisoners so that the ship will not sink. But this centurion called Julius, Paul had favor with him, and he said, let's throw the cargo and not human beings. And even as they did that, they still had problems. And Paul stood and said, none of us here, 276, none of us here will get lost. We'll all sail to the sea. And we'll arrive safe. None of us. For the angel of the Lord has come and spoken to me and said, take heart. Not even of your hair will get lost. And Paul comforted everybody else. And they got to this small island, and the ship cannot go, and they all come out, and they are taken out there at night, and it's very cold. The Bible says that Paul gathered some firewood somewhere, and even as he was doing that, the snake caught on his hand, and he was beaten by the snake. And everybody says, why is he the only one beaten by the snake? Why not all anybody else? This must be a murderer. He must die. And they waited for Paul to drop there, and he did not. In fact, he ended up praying and even encouraging those who are the tribes that went through. But the Bible says, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. All of us here are going into the storm. We are going into the storm. Or you are already in the storm, or you are coming out of that storm. None of us will escape that. But my prayer is, in that moment of being in the storm, we'll find something and hold on. And remember, it is in that moment of hardship that God will reveal himself, will come. I'm reminded of this one man. Some of you have known him. And his story is very sad. Just almost like the story of Job, but this one lived in Chicago. born out of the world. But he lived in Chicago in 1871. And this man called Horatius Crawford, you know him, he was a campus lawyer in Chicago. He had all the world being a lawyer, but also a God-fearing man who was meeting him. And he was married to this woman called Hannah. And they did not have children for so long. And they prayed to God, and they called people in their home for prayer. Oh, pray for us, that we can have this and have a child. God bless them. And they had four daughters. And God bless them, they had a son. And then when the boy was 4 years old, he died. And they were asking God, how comes we did not have children? And this is the only son you have given us. And then, at the age of 4 years, you have taken it. They were devastated. And at a certain point, Spafford told friends, so we need to take a vacation to go to Europe. And we are going to England. And him and his friends, as they were just about to go, because the fire, the great fire of Chicago had broken and burnt everything, including his business and his estate, and everything was in ashes. As he was packing things to go, and they were on the way to go to New York so that they can board the ship, he was called back and was told, oh, you need to come back to Chicago because there is all this gathering of information about the properties that were banned. I don't know whether it was about insurance or about what. And his father told his family, the four daughters and his wife, he said, it's okay. You guys, you can continue. Go to New York, get board the ship. I'm going to go back to Chicago, take care of this issue here. I'll follow you. And they went to New York. And they were off, and they were in the middle of the sea when this British vessel that was coming in the middle of the sea, in the darkness, came and hit the ship that the wife and the four daughters were. And you know the story. The ship sank, and the four daughters were drowned, except his wife, Anna. She was rescued, but very unconscious. And she was taken to the hospital. And when she gained her consciousness, she texted telegram, and in those days they used telegrams. She texted the husband and said, save the Lord. She did not say the children have perished, but she just said, save alone, what shall I do? And Spafford quickly got into another vessel, and he pleaded with the pilot, and he told the pilot, as you sail through, how are you to stop where my two daughters perished? In the middle of the night, the pilot went there, and he came out, and he just looked from the vessel and in the midst of the darkness, he may have probably thrown some flowers into the ocean. And he looked at that place, and he said, it is well with my soul. And then when they arrived and he saw his wife, even after they hugged each other, the wife kept on crying and said, save alone, what shall I do? And Spafford said, it is well with my soul. And if you go to Israel today, in Jerusalem in particular, you are going to see the wonderful work these two couples have done, even after that tragedy. They feed the hungry, well, of course they have a long end. But the organization is still working today. And they still feed the hungry. They still take care of people. And God prepared for this to happen through this prayer. For the grace of God is sufficient. And the strength of God is found in the midst of the wickedness. And you see what happened. It's powerful and hungry. They could not find any solace in their life other than going there to Jerusalem and start serving and looking at every soul and help them out. out of this tragedy. For some of us, we go through these things, and we cannot even remember what we can do and thank God for, because we don't think there's anything we can thank God for. We cannot say, oh, the year 2018 was a good year, thank God. It's hard for us. But yet, we realize in the midst of weakness, there's something that God wants to do. In the midst of weakness, he was able to make Paul write all these books that we need to read, 13 of them specifically. And in the midst of all these weaknesses, Job was able to stand again and became a hero of faith. In the midst of all these difficulties, Hannah was able to stand again. And even as she gave Samuel to the temple for the sons of God, Hannah was able to stand. This church will stand. It is in the midst of weakness that God is establishing something. For if you remember the olive, cannot produce the oil that we love. Last week I was driving along Bloomberg, and I got a call. And guess where this call was coming from? From Eunice. Come and say, please pass by Walmart and get me oil. I say, which oil? Virgin what? Let the virgin olive come. And I bought two of them. I bought two big containers. Specifically that one. And even I said, I look through and I see how beautiful it is. And that the same oil we use. Because we buy our oil from Israel. We don't buy it from the store. We get it right. And I was thinking, oh God, look, we see the oil, but we don't know the process before it gets to be an oil that we use. Look at the process, the press, the crush, and yet this is what comes out. Out of all these, God is going to bring something, and we all going to glorify him, for he is good God. The Bible says in Matthew 5, verse 10, it says, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kind of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And 1 Corinthians 10, 19 says, not temptation that have come to you, which is not common to all men, and the Bible says, but God is so faithful that even in the midst of all that temptation, persecution, and trials, he says he's faithful, he'll find a way for you to stand. Let's all stand. As we believe in this God, whatever you're going through, you know that something good will come out of it. Our Father, our God, we thank you for reminding us that you have not forsaken us. You did not forsake your servant Paul, you did not forsake your servant Job, we did not forsake the servant Anna. And God, we know, even ourselves, we don't know what anybody here among us is going through. But we remind us, this is just a temporary wilderness. You are going to bring us through. You are going to see us through. That's why we worship. For God, you have said, you will never forsake us, you will never leave us. We are walking with you, and your presence is very much with us. That's why you have come out over us, more than over us. That's why we are victorious. We give you glory and honor for this. We pray in Jesus' name. Let's give a mighty hand to the Lord. We have a seat. And I know we're going to be rushing out of here. We are 1 minute late. Can we have the media announcements, and then acknowledge some people? And then we're going to have lunch.
support and Gaki and the Brothers and Teachers who get out of your church and get all the office from Monday to Wednesday at 8 a.m. to 2 p.m. Bless us for coming to the Music Academy available and start the Lawrence Kids I will teach and train piano, bass, guitar, drums, keyboard, and etc. Bless us for both adults and children. See Lawrence. For ongoing congregation events, Bible study will be bi-weekly, Saturday at 9 a.m. And then men's prayer breakfast the first Sunday of the month at 8 a.m. And the keepers will have the second Sunday of the month and catches the last Friday of the month. And the hospitality group assignments, Redland Hospitality Group, held by Mary McGuire, will be serving refreshments next Sunday.
Yeah.
so many of them, says, well, what's the problem? There's money for this official now. Here's the check. But here we have one who will not write a check without praying. We have somebody who will be asking, okay, God, what do you want me to say? What do you want me to do? You can, for the first time. And so I'll give them just this mic for a few minutes and then we'll all stand as we pray for them.
So my words this morning are from the good afternoon. That did say morning before, but I subscribed to it. Cosa Capisa, I've been with San Alessandro. Stand up against corruption and deliver opportunity for the of the nation, Victoria and I will stand by their side. No longer should corruption rob the good people of Kenya of the deserved benefits of a robust economy, democracy, and dependable institutions of all the world. As leaders continue to step up and lead by example to love one another, they will deliver the peace and stability for much needed prosperity. Lazima Pendo Kila Mamoja. We should not cease to celebrate the uniqueness of our cultural heritage or our ethnicity. But we must never allow differences or pride to prevent the much needed unity. Hatred, backbiting, bitterness, arrogance, nor corruption should be allowed to get in the way of our national pride and prosperity. As Americans and Kenyans, an exceptional nation is characterized by exceptional people. Exceptional people are citizens who love one another. Psalm 34:14 says, "Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it." The Message translation says to embrace it. Don't let it go. From Psalm 29:11, let me tell you, may God, may the Lord give strength to his people, and may he bless his people with peace. Asantene, to the final kazi. May God bless you. May God bless Kenya. May God bless the United States.
Jesus. Your word says that
late. Thank you, because the assignment is on time. And you are putting them in this office at this time with a reason. And may your purpose and your plan be accomplished. We want to acknowledge you and we won't lean on our understanding. Even then, we will not lean on your understanding. Every step of it, we will acknowledge you, that it may continue to perfect their ways. Perfect every way in the name of Jesus. Father, we present to you with every blessing from on high. And it is in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. And our God, now with the one voice, you know, in agreement, we pray that you're going to order their steps. From heaven, you're going to open windows and doors of heaven to shower them with the blessings of wisdom and the blessings of favor. For God, we know when a king who fears you sits on the throne, the country prospers. And we pray that, God, the country will prosper for putting people who fear you, people who acknowledge you, people who will come to you asking so that you can give them answers. Bless them. We pray that no sickness, no destruction upon their family, upon their life, that will ever come to them. And we pray that, God, because of the fear that they have in you, you are going to surround them with your favor and mercy and grace. We thank you for their devotion, for the commitment, even for the word. Bless and keep them. For this we pray in Jesus Christ, and the whole church say together,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. To give us some direction, and Mr. Mukai, if you can lead the choir song into the office, please.
Praise God. I'll give you directions very quickly. The most important one today, the most important in terms of direction, is to hope that the Patriots don't win today. That's the most important in terms of direction. Then we all go for the Rams. So remember that. In the meantime, if you're a visitor and you're here for the first time, just remain behind and I will direct you to the gym. We've all gone to the gym. Everybody else, the food is ready. Let's all go direct you to the gym. If you have kids, we have arrangements for them. Do not take them to the gym. They have to be this side from the door entering the gym to your left-hand side. So leave them this side, make sure you hand them over to one of the classes. We have pizza for them. We have all the arrangements they need that will keep them busy. For everybody else, let's all go to the gym. But if you're a visitor for the first time here, just remain behind and I'll walk you here. When you go to the gym, pick any table wherever you want to sit. But if you're a visitor, make sure you don't sit with the visitor that you came with. Pick one county that will be assigned to you, just a table. That way you get also a chance to interact with Kenyans. Like the four of you, the three of you, don't sit here. I'll get you people to sit with from different counties so that you can get a good network and meet people that you have not met before. Otherwise, after this, we just go to the gym. You have kids to the left hand side. Thank you.
Let's say the grace together, and now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen. Go to be pleased to serve and to love the Lord, because bless you, and go ahead and enjoy the meal. It's free. Just eat as much as you can. Nobody can. Sunday, Sunday.